Okay, in this video, I am going to explain how lymphatic fluid is formed. So let's begin by just pointing out all of the different structures that are in this beautiful diagram here. So this is a capillary bed, mostly blood capillaries, showing an arteriole delivering arterial blood from the heart. So the blood is entering this capillary bed, and of course it diverges into all of these small capillaries and then converges onto a venule, which is taking venous blood towards the heart again. We also have some lymphatic capillaries here, shown in yellow. We'll talk more about those in a second. Notice that we've got fully oxygenated blood with lots of nutrients entering the capillary bed, and of course, as nutrients and oxygen are removed from these capillaries, as we have exchanges with the tissue, we have less oxygenated blood that is returning to the heart. Okay, so a couple of important points about the difference between plasma, which is inside these blood capillaries, and interstitial fluid, which is in between all of the cells and, of course, outside here. And also notice we have intracellular fluid labeled inside these cells here, just to have a complete body water diagram. So one of the big differences between the fluid or the plasma portion of the blood and interstitial fluid is the amount of protein that's in it. And I'm going to indicate this by PR minus, which you guys have seen lots of times before. And I'm not going to label all of these, but realize that there's lots of protein that stays inside the plasma in all of these blood vessels. PR minus and all of these. So PR minus. Oh, and hardly any in the interstitial fluid. So I'm putting a PR minus there, super tiny, virtually none in the interstitial fluid. So PR minus is protein. And because of the high protein content of the plasma has a higher osmolarity overall than the interstitial fluid does. So plasma osmolarity is greater than ISF osmolarity. We'll come back to why that's important. Okay, so the blood arriving from the heart is under a fair bit of pressure because remember, we have to generate enough hydrostatic pressure by the heart to deliver blood to within a cell's length of every cell in the body. And it turns out that the hydrostatic pressure of the blood as it enters a capillary bed is much higher than the hydrostatic pressure of the blood as it leaves. There's lots of resistance as it moves through these capillary beds, so it loses some of that pressure. And you probably recall that when we looked at a graph earlier of MAP, the pressure was much higher in the aorta than it was in the vena cava, where the blood is returning to the heart. So let's indicate with arrows the degree of that hydrostatic pressure. So I'm going to put hydrostatic pressure from heart is going to be these black arrows. And so we're going to draw it. I'm only going to indicate the pressure in these outer capillaries, but realize it's happening in all of these capillaries in here. So I'm going to make a really big arrow at this end and a really little arrow at this end. And so the pressure as we move through is going to get lower and lower and lower. And this pressure is squeezing fluid out of these capillaries. So let me draw some squeezing fluid out on this side as well. And less and less and less is squeezed out as we move through this capillary bed. So the hydrostatic pressure from the heart fluid causes fluid to leave. So fluid leaves blood. That says leaves. Can't really read that very well. Let me fix that. Fluid leaves the blood. Well, if we just kept losing fluid and didn't pull it back in, we would lose blood pressure pretty quickly. And so we have another opposing force that pulls the fluid back in, and that's called colloid or osmotic pressure. And so colloid, osmotic pressure pulls fluid back in, fluid back into the blood. And these are going to be purple arrows. And that's due to these proteins. So the fact that the protein content is so much higher in the plasma than in the interstitial fluid, we're able to pull that back in. And so I'm going to show purple arrows pulling it back in. And I'm going to try to draw these all the same length, because the colloid pressure is pretty much the same all the way across this capillary bed. So we're squeezing fluid out, which helps to bathe all of these cells with nutrient-rich fluid and also oxygen-rich fluid. And then we're pulling it all back, not all of it back in again, but lots of it back in again due to this colloid pressure. And so the question is, who wins this epic battle between fluid squeezing out and fluid being pulled back in? Because they're actually not equal. And it turns out that the fluid being squeezed out by hydrostatic pressure wins, and we end up with a net outflow of about 3 liters a day. Net outflow of 3 liters per day. That is a lot of fluid leaving your blood capillaries, because for the average sized person, you only have 5 or 6 liters of blood in your body. So that would be all lost to your interstitial fluid if you didn't get it back, and your blood pressure would drop really quick. So that net outflow of 3 liters a day is picked up by the lymphatic capillaries shown here, and I only drew a few of them, but they're all interwoven in here, and they pick up that interstitial fluid and return it back to the blood through the vena cava. So the lymphatic system not only is important in its immune function, but it's really important in returning this interstitial fluid that was, or the plasma that was squeezed out into the interstitial fluid, which now is interstitial fluid, and then it gets pulled into these lymphatic capillaries, and then we call it lymph, and then that's returned to the blood circulation again. Now, there's a lot of things that can disrupt this normal balance between the fluid that's in your plasma, the fluid that's in the interstitial areas, and the fluid that's in the lymphatic capillaries. Proteins in your plasma are mainly made in the liver. So if you have any problems with your liver, liver diseases like hepatitis or liver cancer, that will affect the amount of protein that's made in the liver and could disrupt the osmotic balance. So if you have abnormally low protein content in your plasma, then you will not be able to pull as much fluid back, and you will end up losing too much fluid to the interstitial fluid, and you can end up looking kind of swollen and puffy. We call that edema. Edema equals swelling. Or the other thing that can happen is if your hydrostatic pressure is too high, then you can end up squeezing more fluid out, and that would be another cause of edema or swelling. So lots of different problems can upset this balance between pulling fluid back in and squeezing it out.